Tonight I want to talk to you about something that's really significant, and it's the seasons that you're going to go through life. This is probably one of the most important things to know about, and we know on some level already about this, but I want to talk about it. So spring, summer, fall, winter. So I needed a 5 or 6 year old, and they said they were going to send a volunteer up, and I don't know who that is yet, but they might be sending him up. There is a actual 6 year old in the house, and he is coming at this moment. Not too happy about it, but he is coming. So for the record here, could you please state your name?
Jacob.
Okay, Jacob, and you are how old?
6.
I was just confirming here. Okay. So does that mean you've been to kindergarten before?
Yep.
Okay. So did you have a teacher?
Yep.
Okay. What was your teacher's name?
Good.
Yeah, they're hard to remember. I know those teachers are. So did you like go in the morning or afternoon or all day or just whenever you felt like it or what?
When my mom wanted me to.
This is a wise man right here. Wise man. Okay, so Jacob, let me ask you a question. Like, what's your favorite thing to do, either at school or at home? What do you really, really like to do?
Learn at school.
Learn at school? So when your mom makes you, he likes it. He's going to go and learn at school. You don't have to know this, but maybe you will. If you could do anything you want when you grow up, anything you want, can you think of something that would be good and fun to do?
Be a dad.
Be a dad. Okay, so now here's the thing. I'm going to do this play. I'm going to do a play. I'm going to act something out. Okay, okay, you're looking at me like suspiciously. All right, so I need someone like you to help me in the play, and it'll only be for a couple minutes. Would you think you could do that? Okay, now, and I'll have you sit in the front row or whenever, and it'll be real sneaky. I'll say, Jesus called a little child to him, and that'll be your cue to come up here. Think you can do it? And then I'll have you sit in my lap. Not now, but then? Would that be good? Okay, it'll be in just a little bit. Let's give him a hand. He did a great job. All right. That's the springtime, when things are really, really cool, and you don't even have to remember the name of your teacher. They come and go, after all, do they not? You got a new one next year. So something happens when you hit your teenage year where life has changed. And I remember having friends, and we played together, and all of a sudden they weren't playing with me. They were hanging around girls, and girls had cooties, and that was really bad. So I found an actual teenager in the audience. Joshua? No. Josh, come on up here. I told him it would be embarrassing, but not for long. It'll only be a short interview. So, for the audience sake, could you please state your name?
Josh.
Okay, there we go. And you are how old?
15
years old. Now, in New Brunswick, do they drive at 15?
16.
Did you get a permit at 15?
16.
You get nothing at 15. What grade are you in school?
10th
grade. And does it go to 12 or 13? You do stuff here different. Well, okay, that's good, because otherwise it just gets too long. So you don't have to know this either, but if I could wave a magic wand and you could do or be anything in the whole wide world in, let's say, 10 years, and I won't hold you to it if I come back in 10 years and you're something else. But right now, as you think, if you could do or be anything in the whole wide world, what would you think you'd do or be?
Like maybe like an EMT or something.
EMT. Well, that's good. Well, you're representing every young person in the church, and you did well. Let's give him a big hand.
Thank you.
Well, that's worked out so far. I had two volunteers. And now I'm going to go for another one. So, okay. Springtime. It's that guy. And then summer. Summer is when you enter into adulthood. And he's there, but not quite there. There's a lot of things he can do, but, my, he can't even drive yet. What kind of laws you got here in this country? So he wants to go places he can't go, but it's his heart. And I remember when I got to be 18, and I went to Bible college, and I guess I was 19, and I saw a lot of girls, and I saw one I really liked, and she had dancing brown eyes, and I worked my way into her life. Her name was Nancy, and I asked her to go out, and she said yes, and everything was going good, and I was smitten, you know. And so then after a bit, I told her I loved her, and she told me nothing at that time. But eventually she came around, and we got married, and that was wonderful, and I was glad for that. Summertime, you know, you're going to live and be together forever. It looks like it's going to stretch out forever and ever and ever. But they never really told me that somebody would speed up the clock and that the seasons would go very rapidly. And it just seems like a blink. I mean, we were married in 1975, so this year it will be 43 years. I can't believe that time has gone that quickly. Now, somewhere, I don't know when it was, but some time back, I moved from summer to fall, to the fall season. You say, how do you know when you've reached autumn? How can you tell when you've reached fall? Well, it's real easy. You know what happens in fall? Things start turning colors and falling. And then you start having to give stuff away. You know, daddies, that little girl that you held in your arm when she was born, and she would never, ever leave you, and she was your baby. It's in the fall season when that stuff starts happening. You see some guy, and he's talking to her, and you're not really happy about it, but you work with it, you know. And then you have to give them away. You have to give them away. Now, I have an opportunity here. Is there some father here, and you can point to them so I can embarrass them. Is there some father here who has a daughter who's not yet dating yet, but is going to be very soon? Is there somebody I can embarrass? I just need to... Anybody like... If it's not happening, it won't happen. You're all kind to your neighbors, and nobody's pointing at anyone else. And no one's volunteering either. That's the other thing. I see these girls over here, so I'm thinking that some of them might have a father here. Is there anyone that would... Oh, wait, they're pointing. Who is it? Yeah. Jeff Brown? Who is that? Point to him. Okay, we got this. All right, let's do this thing here. Okay. So I need you to stand because people really want to hear what you have to say. Now, I don't want to know which one's your daughter. I don't even want you to look in her direction. But if there's one thing that you could tell your daughter about the kind of guy you want her to marry, what would that be?
Honest, working, Christian.
It's up to you. This is your chance to tell her. You don't get what I'm doing here. I'm trying to help you out here. You're saying, if I could tell you what it would be. So do it again. You'd said everything right. So hold the microphone with gusto.
I'd just rather she didn't get married.
Okay. Let's give him a hand. Okay. I don't even want to know who the daughter is. It's just not worth it. Some point or another, I entered into the winter season. Don't know when that was. I'd like to think I wasn't in the winter, but that would be self-delusion. When you're looking at retirement, you know, you're thinking, okay, well then, and then end of life stuff, and you just want to end well. You want to do right. Well, it's a hard time. And physically, things start going haywire on you, and that's not good. And then the jobs that you once had where you're so integral to doing stuff, particularly guys, you have to sort of give them away. And sometimes you give them away slowly, but sometimes you give them away quickly. And then the question that we all have, well, what good am I now? Well, let me just tell you, there's some people that are integral in my life who have shown me the way. And who are even now showing me the way. And it has nothing to do with what they're doing or their job title, but it's their faithfulness to God. And they're showing me how to walk the path and be faithful to God. I have some heroes in my life. My father-in-law was a church planner. And he not only showed me how to live, but he had a dementia. He could tell us his name or our names, but he'd hug us and love us. And he just wanted to go home. And he showed us how to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I want to say thank you to the saints here who have lived for the Lord through thick and thin, and you're in your senior years like me, and you wonder the same questions I wonder, but I want you to know you are such a blessing to this church. Well, okay. I'm going to turn this microphone off and see if I got this other one on.
Since they gave me the chair, I need a 30-second window here, so just pause. Serious. I will praise you from fearfully and wonderfully made. And that my soul knows right well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes saw my substance, not yet formed. And in your book, they were all written, the days fashioned for me, when as yet there was none of them. And the Lord God made man of the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of and man became a living soul. So, God made man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them.
Laughter
As newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby. And Jesus said to them, have you never read, out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants you have perfected praise? Then Jesus called a little child to him and said to them, most assuredly I say to you, unless you're converted and become as this little child, you'll by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives a child like this in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones to believe in me to sin, it would be better for him that a millstone were tied about his neck, that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. The Father of the righteous will greatly rejoice, and he who begets a wise child shall have joy of him.
Thank you.
Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart from it. I am the springtime, when every day is so fine, whether rain or sunshine, you will find me playing. Days full of pretending, when a dime is allowed to be spending. A time when life is just beginning. I am the spring time. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before I sanctified you, I ordained you to be a prophet to the nations. Then said I, Lord God, I cannot speak because I'm a child. But the Lord said to me, say not, I am a child, for you shall go to all that I send you, and whatever I command you, that you speak. Even a child is known by his doings, whether what he does is good and right. Come, you children, listen to me, and I'll teach you the way of the Lord. Oh, well, he's coming, so that's good. Very cooperative. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I thought as a child. I understood as a child. But when I became a man, when I became a man, when I became a man, I put away childish things. I am the summer when days are warm and longer, and the call it comes to wander, but I can't go far from home. When girls become a mystery and you're barely passing history, and being old is when you're 30. I am the summer. You are my hope, O Lord God. You are my trust from my youth. O God, you have taught me from my youth. And to this day, I declare your wondrous works, who satisfies your soul with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Even the youth shall faint and grow weary, and the young man shall utterly faint. But those who wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Flee also youthful lust, but follow righteousness, faith, love, peace. Let no one despise your youth, but be an example of believers in word of conduct and love and spirit and faith and in purity. Who can find a virtuous wife? For her price is far above rubies. He who finds a wife finds a good thing, obtains favor of the Lord. Tell me, oh, who my soul loves, where you feed your flock, where you make it rest anew. For why should I be one as veils herself by the flocks of your companions? If you know not, oh, fairest among women, follow in the footsteps of the flock and feed your little goats by the shepherd's tent. I've compared you, O my love, to a company of horses, Pharaoh's chariots. Your cheeks are lovely with rows of jewel, and your neck with chains of gold. Houses and riches are inheritance of the proud, but a prudent wife is from the Lord. Therefore, shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. So husbands ought to love their wives as their own selves. No, no, but hate themselves. Therefore shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined to his wife. They shall be one flesh. Drink water out of your own cistern, and running waters out of your own well. Let your fountain be blessed. Rejoice with the wife of youth as a graceful deer, loving doe. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived. A woman, when she's in labor, has sorrow because her hour has come. But as soon as she gives birth, she remembers no more the anguish for joy that a human being is born into the world. Behold, children are heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb are his reward. Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed. But they shall meet with the enemies in the gate. Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain and build it. Unless the Lord keeps the city, the watchman waits but in vain. It is vain for you to rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. For so he gives his beloved sleep
The sleep of the laboring man is sweet, whether he eats little or much. But the abundance of the rich will not allow him to sleep. Lord, make me know the end of my days, that I may know how frail I am. I am the autumn days, when changes come so many ways. Looking back, I stand amazed that time has gone so quickly. When love is more than feelings, it's fixing bikes and it's painting ceilings. It's when you feel the cold wind coming. I am the autumn day. One generation passes away, and another generation comes, but the earth abides forever. The sun goes down to rise again. The wind goes toward the south and turns around to the north, comes again on its own circuit. All the rivers run into the sea, and yet the sea is not full to the places that they began. There they return again. All things are full of labor. Man cannot express it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, or the ear filled with hearing, whereas you know not what will be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Vanishes away. Vanishes away. Children's children, grandchildren, are the crown of old men, and the glory of children are their fathers. The silver-haired head is a crown of glory, if it be found in the way of righteousness.
Indeed, you've made my days as handbreadths, and my age is as nothing before you. Every man at his best state is but vapor. I am the winter, days are cold and bitter, the days I can remember, they number more than the days to come. It's when you ride instead of walking, and you barely hear the talking. Goodbyes are said too often. I'm the winter, but I'll see springtime up in heaven. It'll last forever. Remember your Creator. In the days of your youth, before the difficult days come, when you'll say, I have no pleasure in them, will the sun or the moon or the stars not shine? Remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Where the strong men bow down and the grinders cease because they're few, and those who look out the windows grow dim. Remember your Creator, for the doors are shut in the street and the sound of grinding is low. You said your sleep in, but he shall rise up at the sound of a bird. And all the daughters of music will be locked. Brought low. Also, they're afraid of height. Terror's in the way. The almond tree shall flourish. And the grasshopper shall be a burden. And desire shall fail because man goes to his eternal home and mourners go about the street. Remember your Creator, for the golden bowl is gone. The silver cord is loosed. The pitcher is broken at the fountain, or the wheel is broken at the cistern. Then the dust shall return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return to God who gave. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So, when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it has not yet revealed what we shall be. But we know that when we see him, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We know that this earthly body, this tent is destroyed. We have a building of God, not made with hands, eternal in the heavens, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who will change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working by which he is able to subdue all things to himself. Hallelujah. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death or sorrow. There shall be no more pain. For the former things are passed away. Therefore I say to you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or drink, or for your body, what you shall put on. After these things, the Gentiles, your heavenly Father knows, he knows, he knows that you have need of them. But seek ye first, seek ye first the kingdom of God,
right,
and his righteousness,
right,
and all these things shall be added unto you. Would you stand with me and lift your hands to the Lord as our musicians come? Hallelujah. Would you thank him that he knows where you are?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I was in the pastor's office, and I saw this rather odd picture. I had no idea who it was. Just people from another era. And he told me who it was. It was an engagement picture. Him and his wife, and I just couldn't believe it, but sure enough, it was true. So I thought I could show you an old picture. I don't know if we can drag it out. But it's from 43 years ago. It's from June 3rd, 1975. And it may or may not be able to appear. There it is. You know, I've always loved the Lord, and I've always served the Lord. And so I've pursued the call of God in my life and figured, life would be great. I went into ministry, youth pastor, and I, don't click yet, that wasn't a signal. I went into youth ministry, and then I was evangelist, and we started a church, and then after several years, we decided we'd have a baby. You know, you're going to have the picket fence and the dog and Suburban or minivan or something. And had a little trouble having the baby, but then finally the doctor said, yes, it's going to happen. And so that's what the baby was going to look like, the Gerber baby. Everybody knows that's going to be the baby you have.
But and I went to all of the classes. You know how that is. Don't flip. These are not signals. So just I will tell you later. I'm not tricky at all. I will say click or something like that. We went to all the classes and everything was cool until the day the baby was due, very day. And the doctor did one last examination. And he said, Mr. and Mrs. Norris, something's wrong with the baby. And I said, what? He said, well, you're sure of the due date? Yeah, yeah. Well, there's not enough amniotic fluid and his head's too small. I said, well, what does that mean? He said, well, I don't know. Well, what could it mean? And everything he told me was bad. You know, he could maybe didn't have kidneys. Well, what would happen then? Okay, what else could it mean? And in a Wisconsin snowstorm that night in February, our baby decided to make an appearance. Well, almost an appearance. There was a little struggle along the way. Nancy was taken by an ambulance to the hospital because our little town didn't have a hospital big enough. And throughout the night, she wasn't able to have the baby. The baby was in distress. So in the morning, the doctor said, I'm going to do a C-section, and wheeled her away. And I waited at the intensive care unit, neonatal intensive care unit. Big, tall doctor by the name of Dr. Rob. I knew he was in trouble because he didn't take his mask off. He said, Mr. Norris? I said, yes, sir. He said, we're bringing your baby in now. His hips and knees were born out of joint. We can fix that. Oh, I said, well, what can't you fix? He said, well, he's got something, genetic disorder. Flip the slide now. And sure enough, they brought him in, and he was in critical condition. And the prognosis was so terrible. Can I just say, and it's sad I'm saying this, I didn't know if I wanted him to live. Because I thought, well, who will even love that baby? And again, I'm embarrassed about it now, but that's what I thought. I went into Nancy after she got out of the recovery room. She said, something wrong with the baby in there. I go, yeah. She said, well, then we're going to name him Nathaniel. Because Nathaniel means gift of God. And however long we have him, he'll be God's gift to us. And Abshire, after her dad, I said, well, I don't know, Nathaniel Abshire, Norris, pretty regal name for just a little guy. But when a wife says something, you know the scripture, husbands, obey your wives. Happy wife, happy life. I went home, and we had started a church, and I just went there to pick up my checkbook, and there were all kind of cars. You know, it's a new church, I suppose, 10 cars. What in the world's going on? And the church was praying. There was a guy named Wayne, he'd come into the Lord. Just real stoic, though. I mean, he got the Holy Ghost and everything, but he wasn't. He was pounding the chair, and he was asking God. And, of course, Nathaniel lived. And in operations, he was in the hospital 6 weeks. Click on the next slide. That's Nancy holding him for the first time. Then after 6 weeks, we brought him home, and I found out who would love my baby. We brought him to church the first time. We had to go looking for him. Passed from one to another to another. Nathaniel had Creutzfeldt syndrome. He never walked, he never talked. They said he would live to be about 2, maybe 3, 4. But Nathaniel lived much longer than that. He lived with us in St. Paul and mostly in Dover, Delaware. He was a good boy. He loved to go to church. On the fast songs, he would be happy. There's a tongues and interpretation. I mean, here's a he's never going to talk, but there's another realm of communication. Tongues are rich. He'd get real quiet. It would be something to see. He loved people and played the piano, just teasing. He squeezed dogs. That dog didn't last long in his hand. And he was our boy. He was chronically ill. I didn't know that was a label, but if you're hospitalized 5 times a year, that's what it's called. All the nurses knew him. Nathaniel, you're back. Nancy was such a trooper. She does puppets. So she'd be up and down the hall doing puppets, hanging quilts and potpourri. I was a wreck. That's my boy in the hospital. Like, he lived to be about 13. And then he had recurrent bouts with aspiration pneumonia and some other things. And every time he's operated on, he almost died. So the doctor said to us, you know, if he has another bout, would you consider letting him go? Because you're into some heroic stuff here now. He's been through a war. I wouldn't consider it, but Nancy, the more sense, and finally that came around. I said, well, if that happens. And so we got to stay with him. We knew he was dying. Nancy rocked. She told him his life story, why he was special. And she said, Nathaniel, in a few minutes you're going to leave my arms and you're going to go into the arms of Jesus. And so quietly that we didn't even know he was gone at first. That's exactly what happened. We're going to see him again. We don't have hope in this life alone, but in the life to come. And he'd be walking and talking. They had the funeral, and Nathaniel loved balloons. He liked to lick them. He'd get the Mylar all over him. He thought he was big stuff. And so churches sent balloons, hundreds of balloons. We released him at that point. When he was well, he'd go to school. He'd come home. We had a nurse who gave him a bath. He had a special chair for that. And she loved him, and he loved her. And he would splash. That's one thing he could do. And she let him do that. And he splashed. The entire bathroom was full of water. And he had a routine in the afternoon. And he would come and then get rocked in a rocking chair, ready for a feeding. Nice clean jammies and all that. If I was home, I would be there. And the same story played every day. It was the Velveteen Rabbit. Meryl Streep narrating it. Once there was a Velveteen Rabbit, and in the beginning he was quite bushy. Well, when he heard the music and he's getting rocked, he just went, ah. Didn't matter. Didn't matter that he wouldn't walk or talk or play football or be a preacher or a Bible quizzer. It was enough that he was my son. And I loved him because he was my son. We know that. That's how God loves us. That we don't have to do anything to please him. We know that intuitively when we come to church. But sometimes we forget later on. We think he loves us just how hard we work for him. I just leave it on that one. I'm just doing my hands accidentally. I don't know. But he loves you right where you are. You know, maybe you were looking forward to the next season when you could drive. Or if you could just get a girlfriend and She turned out to be not such a hot girlfriend. Or if we could just get married, and then you got married, and then there's all those bills. And then if you could just have children, and then you got children, and they're up in the middle of the night, these crazy kids, and then they cost so much, and if they just get older. And you know, the thing is, we feel bad because we ask for it, and we should, but we're struggling in the season. God knows right where you are, and He knows about your struggles. He loves you so much. When Nathaniel, they weren't sure of the diagnosis. I went home that day, and they said, well, maybe it's a skeletal problem, and it's not going to be as severe. So I went home and was sleeping in bed, and the Lord nudged me, and He'll do that sometimes. And so I rolled over and said, who do you want me to pray for? It was just a response, you know. He said, praise me. Well, I knew if He had to command me to praise Him, it had to be not good news. It had to be my son was not going to be what I wanted him to be. I said, no, Lord, I won't praise you. Praise me. I won't. Praise me. The third time I released it. I said, I understand, Lord, I praise you. And when I did that, the peace of God flooded me. You know, there were problems, but I never had the why, because I knew God knew exactly where. Maybe you're in a season, a situation, a circumstance, whatever it is, and you've been at your wit's end, or you don't know. I'll tell you what we need to do tonight. You need to, tonight, not ask for anything, but trust God for the season you're in. We're going to open these altars, and I want you to come and just say, I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. I release it to you. Would you come? These altars are open.